necessary.
ओके सर, वी आर लाइव राइट नाउ.
ओके, सो दिस शुड बी बिगिन. नॉट शेयरिंग द स्क्रीन राइट नाउ. ऑलराइट, अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल एंड वेलकम टू द थर्ड एपिसोड ऑफ बी द वॉइस कैंपेन ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय वीआईटी पुणे एमयूएन. आई वेलकम आवर गेस्ट मिस्टर शेखर गायकवाड़ टू दिस शो. ओवर द कोर्स ऑफ एन आवर वी शैल एंगेज इन अ कॉन्वर्सेशन विद सर ओवर पुणेस फाइट अगेंस्ट कोविड 19.
गट्टे सर है.
So a little about BIT Pune. BIT Pune is a premier engineering college based in Pune, an autonomous institute under University of Pune. It is the top ranked institution among the top ranked institutions of Maharashtra. BIT Pune Model United Nations is a premier flagship event of BIT Pune, a 3-day simulation of United Nations. We've had 4 very successful conferences. And we've emerged as one of the most well-known MUNs of Pune City and Maharashtra. I'm honored to be an alumni of this institute and honored to have been a part of the team that have organized the first 2 editions. Now, coming to Be the Voice campaign, usually BIT Pune Man is a formal conference of 3 days wherein delegates come together. But with the situation of the pandemic, we've started the Be the Voice campaign, which is basically a dialogue about the issues that are being faced by the world. We do that by having conversations with domain experts and individuals such as Shekhar sir, who are practically working towards combating these issues. The talk that we're going to facilitate today is going to be about our new normal, that is the COVID-19 pandemic. Our Prime Minister Modi has called the pandemic as biggest invisible war in our lifetime. That is indeed true. The situation today is grim. As we speak, India inches closer to 5 lakh cases nationally, with Maharashtra state leading the count. Every day we have crores of people putting their lives at risk to make sure that we win this war. Our COVID yodhas, right from our humble safai karmacharis to doctors, from police to civil servants, from chemists to politicians, a wide array of people are at the forefront of this war. And today, we have one of the great generals of this war, the Commissioner of Pune Municipal Corporation, Mr. Shekhar Gaikwad, sir. About sir. Now, without strategy, execution is aimless. Without execution, strategy is useless. And today, our guest is a master of both. Sir is an IAS of Maharashtra cadre, the Municipal Commissioner of Pune Municipal Corporation, and is a chief guest of the core team of the Chief Minister leading the response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Apart from the current position, he has held many important posts in the state, such as the Commissioner of Sugar, Collector of Sangli District, etc. Along with being a bureaucrat, he's a prolific author, and he has expertise in land laws and general administration, writing several popular books, such as Sheti Che Kaide and Land Laws in Maharashtra, which have been very popular among farmers and laymen for their easy and lucid language. Sir has also led many multiple innovative campaigns in his career, such as the one-time home delivery of food grains in Nashik, running the first water train to Solapur in the drought situation, and creating the first 4G Wi-Fi city in Islampur in 2015. Sir is also involved in teaching, and he is involved in training of next generation of civil services officers in the State Training Academy of known as Yashada in 1995. We look forward to having a fruitful discussion with sir and gaining an insight into the ground realities of the struggle that our officers go through in such trying times. Before I heed the time to sir, I'd like also to share a very interesting set of documents that sir has shared with us, which is basically the dashboard that the Pune Municipal Corporation has created to deal with this pandemic. As you can see, this is the dashboard that is generated daily. It's a plethora of information, very important statistics that are going to be very crucial for a civic chief to manage his resources. We have a set of analytics, testing volumes, As you can see, the data of Pune is highlighted over here. Comparison with other cities, progress over time which, regarding samples, positive cases, recovered cases, active and dead. Month-on-month update, word-wise update, contact tracing efforts with all categories such as the first contact tracing, home surveys, mobile ambulances, etc. Key action taken. Then we also have the utility of the MPMLA fund that is being utilized to fight against this pandemic. Budget provisions from the mayor and TMC fund. Helplines. And finally, I'll be sharing a couple of pictures with you that I thought were very interesting. So these are basically a couple of glimpses. As you can see, this is the review by Honorable Deputy Chief Minister Mr. Ajit Pawar on the left. We also have a couple of meetings that Sir has convened. This is the Smart City Command and Control Center that Sir will be telling us about. Then shelters for citizens, homeless citizens, migrant workers, mass screening through mobile COVID testing buses, CCC centers across the city, survey of households. We also have the data over here. And doctors at doorstep in slums, which is a very important initiative considering the handicap that our health system faces daily. And our COVID yodhas in action. And finally, the glimpse that we are all very relieved to see, discharging patients after they've been cured of the virus. All right. Now we'd like you to begin the conversation. And firstly, a very warm welcome to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you so much, Yash. Just to look quite young like you, I am in informal dress and very delighted to talk to you colleagues from VIT. This is probably the biggest challenge in this century, I can call. The enemy is not seen anywhere, and we are still fighting a war. And that's the scenario. I checked in history, in 1896, we had a bubonic plague, and the death toll in Pune city alone was around 52,000, spanning over a period of 12 years. It started in 1896. The last victim, in fact, was found in, 1912. So it's a long battle. And we are not seeing the end of the tunnel right now. Nobody is claiming that, Corona would be over by October end, December end. Everyone is, you must have been, you youngster, highly tech savvy. And you must be getting your updates. Right from WHO, everyone is giving, a new date for the end of Corona. Maybe somebody is trailing June 2021. It's such a long battle. And basically, a lot of complications in dealing with a pandemic. For me as administrator, it's a tough time. And, lot of multitasking. At the very outset, I will tell you my working hours are more than 16 hours a day. And no holidays for last 4 months. It all started as a bag. I'll just give you a background how it started and how complicated it is. We got the first corona positive case on 9th of March. Yes. So, and the people came from Dubai. They were the tourists from one tourist group. They had gone to Dubai for 7 days. And the first positive victim was found in Sihagad area of Pune city. And you will wonder that in our smart room through which I have shared this dashboard, we have the best control room, which only 10 or 12 cities in India has under smart city program. Practically, we are monitoring on GIS platform right from day one, the first victim where his house is located, which is the area to be cordoned, which has to be the buffer zone, who are the people should be contact trace immediately. And I would have shared that it's a you know, large series of slides with a GIS mapping, and it shows that the day first victim was found, it shifted the location, geographical location in a city. Later on, it most of the cases are located in the heart of the city, mainly the slum areas, and then the Delhi incident happened, wherein around 160 people came from Delhi, and where we were informed late, after say 15 days, we were informed that so many people attended Delhi function, and they were all scattered people residing in slums and other areas, and masjid also. So where contact tracing took around 3-4 days for us. But after that, suddenly the trend increased. Right now, you will wonder, in 3.5 months, my positive cases have gone up to 14,000, as you must have shared with the dashboard. But the active cases are around 5,300. So roughly, the discharge rate is around 59%. And that's
which is a great relief, right?
Yes. Yeah, it's a great relief. Most of the people, especially the youngsters, having no comorbidity at all, they are getting recovered in a very normal course. The problem is 4 to 5% people who are comorbid have some other ailment associated, pneumonia and diabetes and hypertension and high blood sugar and other comorbidity associated with COVID. And if they remain dormant for 2 to 3 days, remain at home, don't consult a physician in the initial period, the viral count goes on very rapidly increasing, which leads to almost a point of no return. Doctors are trying their best, but in hospital, what has happened is, in case of comorbid patients, it's very difficult to recover that patient. They have to tackle pneumonia, dialysis, blood pressure, sugar simultaneously with COVID. And COVID is making it impossible to get recovered. Especially, I'm worried about very critical patients who have gone to ventilator beds and oxygen beds. And this has created a real challenge for us. In the course of discussion, we'll be discussing mainly what are the challenges right now, what is the roadmap ahead. But at the outset, I must say, we have been in control of the situation, number one. Number two, we applied altogether a different strategy, probably, which other cities and towns have not adopted. And it is the strategy of creating very small micro clusters where we concentrate and make a very strict regulation within containment zone, and while we open up the entire city. It has some social and economic dimensions to this issue. For example, people were under lockdown for 90 days and they had no employment, no daily wage earners were hardly hit. No people were tending towards money lenders for money. Lot of issues, social issues. This has created complications for the managers like us. And right now you will wonder at how many places and in how many directions we are working. But as a general picture, I can tell you, we are working at survey level in the slums. We are working at contact tracing level at home-to-home surveys. We are catering to the quarantines. Our people are working in swab centers for collecting the swabs. Then there is a separate team carrying these swab samples to NIV and testing labs. We have parallelly some 14 testing labs from private sector. We are also working with hospitals to give more beds for patients. We are working in isolation centers for giving food and other facilities, and doctors and medicinal facilities at isolation centers. We are working in CCC centers, DCS centers, COVID hospitals. We are working in the critical centers like Sassoon Hospital for, you know, dead patient management is altogether a different protocol. We are working with some NGOs, you know, fighting with corona victims in, you know, ventilator beds. We are parallelly doing ambulance service in slums, as well as we are also burying dead in crematoriums with the help of NGOs. It is so multitasking. I am almost, you know, daily attending two conferences, two video conferences, one or two actual meetings, one to two press conferences, and talking to around 200 media persons daily. I would really love to see youngsters like you. And recently, one government program is announced, which you know, which will make me to get involved with all educational institutes. This is a ULEAP program, which says universal learning program to all colleges. So it's I think it's a great news for all youngsters from different colleges. You can directly work with city managers and local bodies. Henceforth, we can give you some small stipend, but it would be a lifetime experience to work with us. And I would, at the very outset, I would request VIT to give me two students, bright students in each sector, like social sector, civil engineering, IT sector, artificial intelligence to monitor data. Everywhere I can have some openings for the students who are eager to learn with the district administration.
I think that will be a great opportunity for people like us, definitely, especially with the grim employment scenario. Getting an opportunity to work with stalwarts such as you in the policy field or the execution field would be such a great chance. And I don't think there's any other opportunity that can give us the breadth of what we can possibly get in while people are interning with you. We'll definitely probably communicate it to the college authorities as well. And I think even at the government, there is a great need to publicize this initiative. It's really nice.
Right. I would request all of you to share it on social media.
Definitely. Yes. So, sir, should we begin with the question?
Absolutely, yes.
So, there will be some questions that you have probably touched upon in the course of your speech already. In that case, you can feel free to move on to the next question right away. So, I'll begin. So, the first one is, on a personal and in an official level, what was your first reaction when you heard that the first case has been recorded in the city?
Maybe in other, I don't know about other cities, but I was quite prepared, and there were some preparatory meetings. We had a full-fledged, you know, hospital which was created by Britishers in 1932, called Naidu Hospital, for infectious diseases, and we were quite, you know, prepared for this. In fact, you will wonder, the first positive case came on 9th March, and I had sanctioned around 1.5 crores on 6th of March, and we could procure PPE kits to the extent of, say, 4,000 in number for all the nurses, doctors, etc. So from day one, we were prepared. And this was not the scenario with other cities, and they had to face a lot of issues because they were just watching, they were reading some news from foreign countries, but corona had not actually arrived in their cities. So they were not quite prepared and got astonished to see the numbers rising very rapidly. But we had an experience of SARS H1N1 in Pune. Pune had been prone to viral diseases so far, and our doctor team was also quite prepared. So we were not really shocked as maybe other cities.
Okay. Then next, I think the most important part of probably the government response to the pandemic has been the lockdown. So much so that possibly historians are considering calling 2020 as the year of the great lockdown. The same way we had the year of the Great Depression in 1932. So, obviously, a lot of people will be having a lot of questions with it. But I'll begin with it. As the civic chief, how difficult was it for you to enforce it, the lockdown? And what is your takeaway as a civil servant from it?
The first, reaction to lockdown was very positive from the people. people thought that, you know, lockdown would help in reducing numbers. But practically, enforcing lockdown and enforcing the containment zone is a very difficult task. You know, especially in slum areas. Slum areas, as you all know, are very densely populated slums, you know, have a small walkways in between. And people had to, you know, walk till the common toilets daily. And the first source of infection was seen in the community toilets. Now, in spite of all our effort, these are the learnings for the young generations. We have created community toilet blocks worth 2 crores, 3 crores in one slum. However, the slum toilets are still maintained by the local bodies. And you will wonder that it was difficult to recognize that we need to sanitize the blocks not 2 times as was done earlier, but 5 times in a day. And it took around 8 days to, you know, understand this issue that infection is getting spread through common toilets, then the door handles and the water tanks and taps, etc., etc. So living with corona requires a lot of IEC to be done. And, you know, it's a great challenge. I would request all youngsters to, you know, communicate, spread these measures across the communities. So the first issue was about how to enforce a containment zone. We requested, all the way instructed police to enforce the containment zones very strictly. But this was not possible because, you know, slums is very difficult in a 10 by 6 feet area, a population of 6 to 7, 8 people living under a tin shed to remain seated for 90 days is very difficult during summer time when the temperature is around 40 degrees. Is very difficult. Children used to play around. They used to intermingle with the adjoining slum holders. The seniors and women especially used to sit outside in the slum area and chit-chat with each other. Spread the virus like anything, and slum areas had a contribution of around 80% in the corona positive till May end. However, it also had, social impacts. Lockdown to certain extent was welcomed by everyone. 15 days, after 15 days, you know, people started fading up. Then slowly, the first hit was on the daily wage earners. You know, you will wonder to see the journey as to how it affected poor. First, it affected the daily wage earners. Their daily wage earning stopped. Then they were, most of them were in a rented houses, 2,000-4,000 per month. Now, they felt that if we are at home, we are not getting salary. And if we are not getting salary, then we must give this rented home. Give away this rented room and go to some other premises. So this triggered, you know, migration of labor. You have mentioned that migration of this century in a very large quantities took place. It was only because people felt that surviving in a city would be very difficult. Then later on, people felt that it is better to die among our own community rather than to live in this altogether new city. It created fear among the communities. Another feedback as manager I got from the slum dwellers and poor people and some media persons that people are tending to money lenders for, borrowing money for short, their marginal needs of daily needs. And therefore, it created a cycle where, you know, people, banks were closed, ATMs were closed, people could not move. So they started borrowing money from each other. This created a scenario where, you know, people later on felt that even people went to the extent of saying that we will die of hunger rather than of corona. And this is a common phrase you must have heard about. So this led to a feeling among people that let us open up. And of course, the lockdown was extended in 4-5 phases. But after fifth lockdown, you know, government also eased to certain extent. It affected the government treasures and treasury also, because earnings stopped, GST collection stopped. So paying salary to the, you know, lot of manpower that was working on field. You will wonder around 18,000 people right now from Pune Municipal Corporations are on the ground and on the field, who are, you know, battling right from fire brigade to sanitation workers. So it's a huge number. So even paying their monthly salary would have become, you know, difficult for local bodies. And therefore, opening of city was talked about, and it started on 17th of May, which they called it as Unlock 1. So this eased out the slight, you know, business for the poor people and street vendors and, you know, small petty shop owners. I think micro-containment enforcement is a difficult task. Police also gets feared. They don't walk in by-lanes to stop people. Is the natural environment is such that you know, you cannot enforce people to sit in a small premise and house for hours and days and months together. So it's a difficult thing. And that is why probably European countries said, no, we will open up, we'll not keep any containment zone and lockdown. So this led to this understanding that lockdown is not an answer to this.
Yes, I think a lot of people that have said is the lockdown is merely a pause button that just to make sure that our capacities are built. A general perception among the public being that it will cure the virus is actually quite misplaced.
Yes, because, you know, at the beginning you must have seen and must have heard in newspapers and media too, that earlier, you know, the PPE kits used to be imported. But yes, we created, you know, strength in ourselves. A number of units were approved for PPE, manufacturing of PPE kits. N95 mask itself was being imported in the country. You know, you will, you know, this strategy was good, that it gives you some room to go for manufacturing all out by Indian industry. And right now we are self-sufficient. We are manufacturing thousands of PPEs per day, sanitizers, N95 masks, which were, you know, uncommon, unheard of, are being now easily available with the people. So it took some time, and five phases of lockdown created a lot of infrastructure for us.
Now we have a question from the audience. I'll begin one question from our Dean of Student Affairs, Mr. Rajesh Dhake, sir. So the question goes, what should be the precautionary measures that should be taken by the manufacturing industry? Because as you see, even in the earlier phases, they were a part of essential services, and now in the unlock phases, they are almost entirely open. So looking at the cases where in Pune, in Bajaj plant, we had more than 100 positive cases of COVID-19. What is the strategy and what should be the way forward?
Actually, it is high time, in spite of, you know, COVID guidelines, which are generally applicable to all communities and population across, each manufacturing unit must have some different strategy. For example, a small shopkeeper must have separate strategy than a manufacturing unit. Because for a manufacturing unit, people are coming from different places. Some of them might be from containment zones. So first, they need to check through their HR, you know, data as who is coming from the micro containment zone. That is the first precaution that they should take. In fact, they must have a separate dashboard of their own, which employees are, you know, frequenting to micro containment areas. Number two, they should also instruct their employees not to intermingle in micro containment area. They should not go to visit the relatives which they have so far not visited for very long. You know, they can initially avoid micro containment areas, number two. Number three, they should have sanitation facilities looking to COVID guidelines. For example, if there is a footfall of 100 people in small hall or a manufacturing unit, earlier, there, you know, they must spend more money on sanitation, etc. have must increase the frequency of sanitation of the ground floors and canteens, especially where people you know, gather for food, lunch, dinner, etc. You know, everywhere there is some new learning. For example, in the dining hall or the canteen, where people, you know, can have staggered timings for lunch and dinner. Now, this can easily be done. You know, you can give staggered timings to different units, like manufacturing. A unit can go between 12 to 1. Other B unit can go between 1 to 1:30, something like this. Then thirdly, everyone entering must wear a mask, must sanitize himself, can wear a gloves if can be, you know, he can work in the manufacturing unit with the gloves. Yes, if the gloves are not allowed in a particular area, nylon gloves are not allowed, then he can use cotton gloves. And if not, then every half hour, whenever he touches new area, he can sanitize his hands. So this is like, you know, we need to create a case-specific protocol in each manufacturing unit, depending on the type of industry we have.
Basically, a one-size-fits-all approach will not work. Right. So the next question being, now, as you rightly mentioned, the human migration. It is possibly, a lot of people are saying that it is possibly the largest human migration since the partition times. So it has obviously created so many challenges, not just for the people, but also for the government, right, from law and order to relief work. So one of the main mediums of relief for these migrant workers was the beginning of a Shramik train. We saw that there was a lot of friction between some agencies, perhaps even the Ministry of Railways, along with the state of Maharashtra. So what was it a challenge for you, and how did Pune tackle the Shramik train issue?
Especially migration and train issue related, there were two challenges. The first challenge was some of the you know, states took a view that we will not allow our own people to come within the state. For example, Telangana and UP did not allow anybody in their states initially.
Yes.
Whereas Rajasthan allowed. So this created a scenario where I could fly a train from Pune to Jaipur, but not from Pune to Lucknow. But it was very difficult to, you know, tell this to communities, because communities were mixed. They were, you know, in a slum camp or say with any builder constructing any house, they were a mixed lot of laborers. Some came from Jharkhand, some came from UP, and some were from Rajasthan. It was very difficult to isolate them from each other, saying that your state is not allowing you in the state and that is why we have a problem. So it created a lot of crowds on the railway stations. It created a chaos-like situation. The states took different views. There is a federal system, as you all know, and each state has a freedom to, you know, take its own decision. So this created slight complications. Some of the states, you know, did not allow reverse migration also happening. For example, people from Jharkhand wanted to come back. Maharashtrians from Andhra Pradesh wanted to come back, but they were stranded on the borders. Yes. Karnataka, around 17,000 people were stranded on the borders of Solapur in Karnataka, where Karnataka did not allow them to move inside Maharashtra. So this created a lot of problems for us. But later on, some state governments eased the norms, but till then, migrant people had to face problems.
And I think here, one of the main issues is that a lot of governance nuances are difficult to explain to the masses, as you explained. To explain to a migrant worker that why he can't go to Lucknow but he can go to Jaipur would be a nightmare for a civil servant, I believe.
Absolutely, because there is no, you know, we don't have any inventory, we don't have any contact number of each labor, and the particular unit in which they were working, they had already left them, they were removed from employment. Either they had resigned or gone on leave or something like that. So the connecting institution was also missing.
The next one is for Pune, specifically being, as they call it, Vidyecha Mahergar or Oxford of the East. It is the education hub. Now, a lot of parents particularly, we also have some parents in the comment section. We also have a lot of students in the comment section. All of us have a bit of, are scared about, even if, say, at some point, education institutes will open in Pune. Given the situation, how wise would it be to open it in the first place and for students to attend it if they have a choice?
I think for senior students, you know, lot of learning can happen distantly with, you know, e-learning programs, etc. However, some curriculum is such where you need to attend practicals. And experts in the medical field, they say, Corona is not dreaded virus as against other viruses. It's one of the most mild kind of virus we have. So there is nothing to fear. We can open up. We can open up schools, colleges. For children, of course, we need to wait for some time. However, the youngsters need to take some precaution, like wearing mask would reduce, they say, 55% chance of getting infected. So let us live with Corona and let us not, you know, make economic crisis for us, and that is the view most of the European countries are taking nowadays.
So we have Genome Jen. He is asking, a number of students are facing difficulties in accessing educational material online, and that is not just the young, the very young kids, but also people of my age, and sometimes even the ones seeking adult education, perhaps of your age, or somebody who is you know, getting skill training. Undergoing skill training. So for them, it is very difficult to access online classes. So two questions. One, as part of the government and as Pune Municipal Corporation, since you also have a lot of institutions under you, what is being done to address that? And number two, is it necessary that, shouldn't it be necessary that the schools then be open very early to avoid a gap?
Government has taken a policy decision. On 1st of July, they are starting classes for 9th and 10th. So there would be physical classes. Like we talked about manufacturing unit, they can stagger the batches because the other classes are not, you know, taking place. So classrooms are empty. If there is a batch of 60, you know, they can have staggered timings. Only thing is that the teachers need to teach the same lesson twice for the same batch. That is the only thing. But I think while we, you know, tackle the greatest pandemic, we need to cope with this. And initially, we are by keeping some distance, like we are right now happening meetings. Everything is going on smoothly in government sector. What I suggest is even education institutes must, you know, gear up for this. Initially, they can think of starting some practical classes where, you know, you can have staggered batches, number one. Classroom teachings can happen in different timings. You can at the most arrange, you know, benches in such a manner that you keep some distance, a very safe distance. You can, instead of having a class in a typical classroom, can we move the batch to the bigger hall where, you know, you can keep a distance of 5 feet or 6 feet, and some common halls can be used for classes. So education should begin at any moment.
Yeah. So basically, we have to learn to live with the new normal, I guess, in all sectors, not just education.
Absolutely, yes.
Now, the next question being, basically, contact tracing can be an issue, especially when it comes to slums. Although we've had some interventions such as the Arogya Setu app by the Government of India, I think it must be very difficult for you, considering how Pune is, the demographics and the slums and everything. How did you go about it?
So right now, we have around 900 plus teams going for survey daily in the slums and containment zone. It's a difficult task. We lost around 10 people of ours during this entire, 3.5 months period. Slums, you know, they have to wear PPE kits and masks and, face shields. Go and ask, visit every slum dweller And people are not ready to, you know, reveal the entire information. If somebody is ill because of some ailment, you know, they will not share information. And it's a difficult task for the survey teams, especially ASHA workers and nurses. And then taking daily the oxygen saturation levels, and with the thermal guns, the temperature of each person in the slum area. It's a difficult task. Then there's another team headed by teachers and our PMC staff, which goes on inquiring for 14 days. Whoever is a senior citizen or having some comorbidity, or especially pregnant women. Right now, we in the sixth and seventh phase of survey, we are concentrated on comorbid patients and pregnant women, so that, you know, they are the most vulnerable section in the society. Third challenge is, you know, to maintain community toilets, to give, you know, food supply to them in wherever the containment zone is practically sealed on the ground. You will wonder that I have spent around 150 crores from local body fund so far on corona, you know, measures. So it's a huge expenditure. Daily, I have around 5,000 people having breakfast, lunch, dinner, etc., etc. Some of the calls I got from, you know, some of the positive people in the ward itself, they used to send some videos that for half an hour I have not got tea in spite of admission in my quarantine center. I said, your building alone has around 900 positive people. You will, you know, if our people start giving food plate in each room, no, carrying food to 900 rooms where positive patients are there, it takes around 3.5 hours. It's with proper care, wearing gloves, catching the, you know, holding the plate, and giving every minute thing takes three times more time than the normal time that which would otherwise require. So it's a difficult task, and to satisfy everyone becomes a challenging thing for me.
Yes, definitely. And I think, as you said, as you give that the example of the tea, I think it must be a very tough task for you to balance a long-term policy making with very short-term immediate needs of the citizens. Because yes, both of them are important. So that must be a task.
Nothing can be ignored. Yes. So right now, I'm also parallelly engaged in documenting all my steps right from day one. And luckily, I have done a lot of homework for this. I'll be coming out with 1,000-page document based on how we tackled corona in Pune, which will have, you know, lot of plethora of information on this.
The next question being regarding the conflict of statements, or you know, between the three levels of federalism, basically the union government, the state government, and the local bodies. We've seen at various times there has been, probably due to miscommunication or other reasons, that there has been conflicting statements. How do you deal with that when it comes to you on your level? When citizens come to you probably asking what exactly should we be doing?
What we do is we strictly adhere to ICMR guideline, Indian Council of Medical Research. They are the technical experts who guide the entire country. So what we concentrate on is basically the ICMR guidelines and try to stick up or adhere to strictest of the ICMR guideline itself. Of course, guidelines have also improved or say amended from time to time, because it's a learning thing. We have no standard SOP for this. No country has an answer to this. Therefore, we have to learn, upgrade yourself daily, get updated. There are conflicting views in experts also. Lot of videos you must have seen, right from WHO to Oxford to Stanford to any other university. You know, they are, you know, giving different perspectives to it. But whatever common is there, we try to accommodate.
Yes. In fact, as you mentioned, even at the international level, possibly the biggest health organization, WHO, has given itself some conflicting statements, especially regarding human-to-human transmission early in January. And we're also seeing the consequences of being geopolitically when Mr. Trump is actually threatening to cut off funding for WHO. It is a very massive, unprecedented situation, I believe. Now, we also have a question again back to the education sector. Being a very popular formula, odd even rule. So, odd even rule in education institutions, perhaps a good idea of some sorts.
Yeah, there are alternatives. Like for street shops, we said P1, P2. Like alternative lanes can open up initially. It's the same thing. It's one of the models you can.
Yes. Now we have Rupal Jain. So she is asking about what are the ground steps taken for domestic violence faced by women. Because I remember the Secretary General of United Nations saying that it is the shadow pandemic, the domestic violence against women, wherein women are forced to live in homes where perhaps their abusers or violent members are there. What is possibly that Pune Municipal Corporation has done with it?
We got lot of feedback on this from citizens. Of course, though we are not experts in this field, we have asked some social institutions to have some smaller studies, research studies done. We are being helped by Pune University, Ayuka and other scientists. We are getting help of some IT companies on this. We are getting help of psychiatrists, to deal with. We created one small helpline from psychiatrists because, some few but sporadic incidences of suicides have also happened. One of the very young student, he jumped from our isolation center suddenly when he found that he was positive. Okay. It was actually, there was nothing to fear, but his mother was at home. And there must have been some conversation between the two. The moment he entered the isolation center, within 15 minutes, he jumped from the third floor. I don't know what happened. He would have easily, there was no symptoms at all. He would have easily walked on 7 day home. But, it's very difficult, to understand his psyche as to how what he must be thinking about. So it's a psychological issue, especially people think that, why corona has come my way? Why I was the only, corona positive in the community? So, this type of thinking has no place in the modern scientific world. This logic needs to be developed and percolated down the line through student and young community, which is more rational. People thinking in a slum area that what is the bad thing that I have done in life that I got contracted through virus. Yes. Actually, virus doesn't recognize any community and your needs. But this needs to be digested properly.
Yes, I think there's a word that is being coined for it, COVIDophobia, that basically we are so scared of the virus itself that the fear is greater than the actual virus. Now, coming to the next question, since we are an engineering college and most of the people joining are engineers, a natural question is about technology. And as compared to the previous pandemic that we faced, even as compared to the H1N1 pandemic that you were mentioning, this time the use of technology has been massive across all sectors. So, as engineers, to know what Pune Municipal Corporation has done as far as emerging technologies is concerned. And I'll also, in passing reference, like you to talk about the Smart City Center.
Yeah, somebody can visit our PMC website and Smart City website. You will see that one of the best technologies are being used in Pune. We have a very updated and modern Smart City Control Room, which only 10 to 12 cities in India have. From day one, we are monitoring every positive case on a GIS platform. Not only that, we are practically getting his GIS coordinates in such a manner that our control room can, if he moves from one room to another room, our people used to give call to him that where is your mobile? And people used to, like, Punekers were very sensitive about it. He said, I was fed up answering your calls. I am just wandering on terrace for half an hour and have kept my home mobile at home. So, you know, we could detect technology has helped us a lot in all spheres. Like, number one, creating, you know, database for us. Then mapping data on GIS platform. Then artificial intelligence technology has helped us in, you know, comparing the X-rays of the patients, senior citizens, with you know, patches of lungs and predicting largely whether he will be COVID positive or not in the near future. So and Ayuka and other Pune University scientists are helping us in properly calculating doubling rate and mortality rate and you know, bed capacity, what is the preparedness for the next month, next to next month. So everything is happening with technology. I would, you know, VIT like institution henceforth can have lifetime MOU is with local bodies, so that there is a win-win situation for each of us. You know, you can create technologies and we can give that benefit to the community at large. One of the young students created a small robo for us. Initially, he just 10 to 12 years old. He came with a robo saying that instead of giving the food plate to the positive patient, you can use this robo. But the robo was with a small plate. Then eventually with discussion with us, he could create within a period of 1 month, created a trolley, a typical trolley that any hospital has with the remote and a robo machine. Now his trolley is being used in, you know, Naidu Hospital. Another area that I would share with you is like negative ion generation. You know, it can reduce the viral load in a close area. There are research studies on this. So Science Technology Park gave us 2-3 machines where we have placed them in Naidu and created a control situation where there are machines in 3 rooms and there are no machines in 3 rooms. And we are comparing the data about the viral load and taking count on daily basis, whether patients in a control room get recovered fast with a similar ailment. These are some studies going on. Some research studies are going on with the help of, you know, Serum India and other great institutions. You know, we are also having some trials on positive cases, so medical trials, clinical trials, etc. We are also trying some Ayurvedic and homeopathic medicines, which are approved by Ayush Mantralay and having no side effects about, you know, immunity which can be created among the positive cases. So there is one technology firm in Pune which is managing through AI the medical data of Americans from Pune. It has, you know, 800 people working there. So they are also guiding us in creating a kind of health record of people. You know, if we can know before he enters, any patient entering a hospital, if we can know the history of the patient as to when he got the first symptoms and what is the treatment that he has taken, what is his age, what are the other ailments he has, what are his readings of different health parameters. So, see, if this data can be, you know, created on, you know, some IT device, this would help in helping the pandemics henceforth in the community.
That was a very comprehensive answer. I mean, that is lovely. I'm sure a lot of engineer friends with me would be very delighted to see the use of technology. And I really liked how you mentioned even a simple technology such as a robot with a tray can be such disruptive in these fields. Because whenever we talk about technology, we only think about cutting edge technologies. But even something simple can have such a drastic impact on our fight is really delightful. Yes. Now, the next, we have a question come request basically from our team itself regarding events. So, VIT Pune MUN is among one of the biggest events in Pune. And there is a very natural question from the team. What do you think can be the timeline for probably going ahead with these kind of events, wherein a lot of people from across the state and the country would come?
I think the moment they allow you to have social gatherings, you can continue with your program. And I think I see that probably 15th of July or 30th of July onwards, you can take up this event at any point of time. Of course, we need to see to the guidelines, recent guidelines of the government.
Right. This is, the question was more of a hope rather than a question that everybody is yearning to participate in social gatherings and everybody wants to go out, meet people, and this is naturally a consequence. Now we have a question from Shubham Vispute. The question is, basically, we really appreciate the efforts taken in these times. However, there are need for some more innovative solutions to go ahead with the unlock section. So, do we have to have plans for a platform where citizens can share these ideas?
We have PMC Facebook page, we have PMC Twitter page. I would suggest that people have can place every kind of feedback on this.
Okay. So the next question is basically regarding morale of the frontline worker. Now, as you talked about, a lot of people have also been have lost their lives while taking care of the public health. At this time, people who are in the forces can have a very negative morale at times. What do you think is, what steps have you taken and what can be done?
Surprisingly, you will wonder to see the ground reality that the most senior doctors were afraid to go in COVID wards. But my smallest sanitation worker is not feared of this. So this is a ground reality. We lost 10 people. The first thing that Pune Municipal Corporation did was, Government of India is giving 50 lakh insurance cover to every health worker or anybody working for COVID. In addition, we as add-on, we put 50 lakh on that from PMC funds. And, not only that, we said you will get 75 lakhs plus employment to one of the close relatives. So, or you take 1 crore rupees as cover. So, both the things are promised and we are giving 10 crore rupees for 10 people whom we have lost. But this indeed, it matters. Lot of, labor organizations, etc. met me. And we took very early this decision to give additional cover of 50 lakh rupees from PMC funds. And later on, it was copied by some other corporations also. And I think this is a must that poor people, everybody working in the system must get a confidence as to what will happen to my close ones after, if tragedy happens. So this gives lot of confidence to health workers. Now I can, confidently say that my nurse, my ward officer, my medical officer, my sanitation worker has the fullest confidence in working with COVID.
Right. That is a very delightful thing to hear. Then next we have a question from Malvi Dhedia. The question goes, now, regarding corporate retrenchment, not just corporate, even industrial, where we are seeing a large-scale, massive layoffs with workers and even IT professionals. So, we've already seen in the Atmanirbhar package that the government of India has actually taken some steps regarding that. On a local level, what is the stance of PMC on that?
That is why 98% of Pune city is now open. This, it started migration. Not only stopped migration, it has created a situation where last month alone, we got 30,000 people back from who had migrated to other states have come back to Pune. So it's a good sign. It's high time now we open up restaurants and hotels, etc., with some guidelines being given to them, because lot of employment opportunity lies in the in such sectors. We should also open up malls where we can have staggered timings. With small care, we can happen business business we should allow to happen on the ground, because this would create employment opportunity. What has happened is it's a dependent kind of system. Because the industry is closed, people are migrating, and because the people are migrating, the industry is closed.
Yes.
So we egg and chicken kind of thing. But we started some industries in Pimpri Chinchwad and Chakan, where they are facing a lot of problem of want of labor. So they want labor to come back immediately. And so therefore, easing of business would help in the long
run. Yes. We have a question from Vikrant Bhalerao regarding a very recent incident about a mock drill being conducted in Pune, if I'm not wrong, near Deccan. Basically, how should people, government, be prepared for these kind of mock drills? And what is your experience? Because the thing is, a lot of citizens, because of COVID-phobia, the mock drills can also have a lot of negative consequences unintentionally.
So I could also go through that video. The intention was to create awareness what would happen, but people, once this video gets forwarded to somebody else, the text or the background of it goes on missing. So it's a learning for those people creating IAC material, that while they innovate and create something very creative, they should also take care that it's a false scene created for the awareness of the people, because people felt that it was real, and therefore
there was a lot of panic among people.
Yes.
And I think regarding the same thing, not just miscommunication, there are sadly a problem
we put in every book and every video. This has to go somewhere. It's a learning for people creating.
Yes. In fact, on the same lines as you mentioned about the message forwarding, or the text not going, there's also parallelly a problem of fake news. And it's not new for us. I mean, we've seen since 10 years, fake news has been a big problem in our society. And even the Prime Minister mentioned it at the SAARC summit that he had held recently. So at the local level, fake news probably can be easier to tackle than at national level. How do you think that can happen?
What I have experienced so far is that sometimes the news is not so fake, but it becomes irrelevant after 24 hours or so. But the same news gets forwarded after days and months. And a scene which was real 2 months ago and has become irrelevant, it suddenly gets cropped up in some new community. So it must have some expiry date that it is relevant only up to Saturday. Something like this has to happen.
Yes, and I think the government has a big role to play, as you said about the IEC messaging. It has to be very careful, and probably with the necessary steps wherein we can possibly have a watermark in the video, or we can have necessary cautions in the messaging. That's a very good idea, sir. I mean, yes.
Right.
Definitely. Now, the next question being about best practices. We have Garvit Birani, who was asked that since being an administrator of such a large metropolitan city, what unique challenges specifically you have to face, and what can other cities learn from you?
You will wonder that we control the areas like Bhavanipet and Nagpur Chal in Erauda and Patil Basti in Pune. They are so densely populated, congested slums that suddenly we found that messaging to people or contacting them, there was a need for public address system. So we created public address system in the slum, and we said, now you will get at the entrance gate, the milk wala is here. You can take within half an hour or 1 hour the milk from him, and then he will not be available on the latter part of the day. So addressing the communities, like a typical village can have audio system. We feel that in urban areas also there is a need to have some alarm kind of system plus some two-way communication system being present. Number two, as far as sanitation is concerned, everywhere there has to be some care to be taken by the communities. And it was very difficult for people to understand that the same door handle, which was being touched by around 100 people, 50 people per day, they were contaminating through the handle. It took us 4 days to learn this. So what we created was a piece of paper. Everyone who entered in the community toilet must use paper while catching the handle. Then some innovation was brought in. Somebody created a small plastic structure, you must have seen, which is called a sixth finger. You need not touch, you can just hold it in a finger and need not touch any button of a lift or did not open directly any handle or a door by hands. So without touching surface, you can have your sixth finger. They have called innovatively as sixth finger. So use of technology is very much relevant, but some of the innovations have helped. What we did was practically man the road towards community toilet from each slum lane. So then we said, okay, community toilet is at 4 places and for any particular sum of 5,000 people. So what we did was practically we blocked the area lane wise. Only four lanes people would go to a toilet. Other 4 lane people will go to B toilet. We also thought about differential timings being allotted to slum dwellers. It's a lot of learning for us. And everyone, like from UNICEF, everyone is wondering as to how, you know, we can innovate in different ways.
I'm sure that Pune model under your name would probably be very famous. I'm sure it is already. And in some time, we'll get to hear more about it on the media channel. Next question is on a relatively personal level. We have Pankajji Patni from Nashik asking that since you mentioned about 16 to 18 hours working and no holiday for such a long time, it can definitely be very tiring. How do you go about it managing health-wise? And parallelly, we also have a question from Pushkar Marathe, wherein he is asking about the role of exercise and immunity boosters. So if you can possibly shed some light on that.
At personal level, I am taking, you know, earlier I used to take a glass of milk, now I am taking it with haldi. So it's like just an immunity booster, and I am taking one small Ayurvedic preparation daily just to keep myself fit. Of course, my exercise is now not happening, but care has to be taken, and mostly I am avoiding tea during office hours. I am especially avoiding any food outside. Anyway, the restaurants, hotels are closed, but any chance of getting infection is being avoided at every point of time.
Okay. And as a civil servant, you've gone through so many posts. Even in the post as the post of collector of Sangli and in the post of sugar commissioner, you must have had many challenges and you must have learned things. How were your previous experiences as a bureaucrat with such a vast and illustrious career helpful for you right now?
Like I worked for the earthquake of Latur in 1991 to 94, the period in which I was at Solapur. I also tackled the scarcity situation in Latur, etc., as Sangli collector. But this particular pandemic has two different things altogether, which can be called as specialties. Number one, in drought situation or earthquake or any natural calamity, you can calculate the dimension of the challenge. Now, here is a scenario where your enemy is not seen and you are still fighting. That's a difficult task, number one. Number two, there seems no end to this scenario. Like, I walked through, you know, dead bodies of around 600 in number on the day one in 93 Latur earthquake. I was stunned. But then, over months of working, I lost 6 kg of my weight that time. We worked very hard, but there was an end to it, that Yes, after 15 days, everything would be normal. People need to, you know, have the spirit of creating a new world altogether for themselves. But for pandemic, it's very difficult because, you know, nobody's sure as to what is going to happen, number one. Number two, uncertainty surrounding this. The third is your movement, your restrictions, etc. have made you introspect. And what you introspect is largely governed by media. And media is what almost COVID. So in this scenario, you know, people are getting some psychological problems that apparently is seen on the ground. They need to interact with their close ones. They need to talk to them. They must share. This is the only challenge that we are right now facing. People are, the world has become one. People are saying that in places like Italy where, you know, son doesn't know where his father has is admitted. Father doesn't know whether his son in the other ward has already died. And there's a very panicky kind of situation there. So far, looking to situation in Italy and Spain, etc., we have been largely successful in at least ensuring beds for treatment, number one. We have been successful in ensuring that even when 98% of the city is open, you need not be fearful. The third message I want through you, youngster, to go to people is that if you are positive, corona positive, and if your immunity is good, you have no other ailment, there is nothing, absolutely nothing to fear about. You can just walk in any COVID center instead of hospital, because hospital, you know, their meter would start running from day one when you occupy the bed. And this has been largely the scenario. So another observation is that our public infrastructure of health needs to be improved a lot and must be in a competition to private sector. So we have so far ignored the public sector health infrastructure. We need to concentrate on this. But best of the European countries also failed in giving treatment to senior citizens. Ultimately, some of the European countries has to make a choice that if young COVID patient of 40, they used to admit, and young COVID patient of 70, they said, no, you please be at home. So there, they started making selection among the COVID people. That's a bad scenario for the human mankind, and therefore mankind need to rethink. They said they need to rewind. Your money has become irrelevant in modern times. So you must share your sorrows. You must share with pain with the community. You must help community to build up the health infrastructure. You must also set your priorities right. Whether you need food kits being given free to people or you need the COVID treatment to people. So that again needs a choice of the communities, and that needs to be done intelligently by the people.
Now we'll be taking last two through three questions. So the next question being about the role of civil society and NGO. We are seeing across all media channels that civil society and NGO are fighting hand in hand with the government against this pandemic. They've played a major role, right from individual actors such as Sonu Sood to big organization to even corporate. So what has been your experience in working with these people, and what do you think they can do better?
My experience has been very good. Lot of NGOs came forward to work with us. They help in giving ambulances, doctors, etc. They helped in contact tracing in the slum areas. A lot of donations came from CSR and NGOs. Almost we have not bought any N95 mask and PP kits for last 2 months. Everything is being donated by the community organizations, NGOs, CSR companies. Everyone is coming forward to help us. However, what I felt the need is they need a small, you know, interaction from the local bodies about the priorities they have. For example, somebody came with a face shield. Then immediately after NGOs came the profiteering companies who were just, you know, running after us to buy face shields, which were not required by us. But then they started a vendor-driven kind of program. Every week I used to meet at least 100 people selling their products like face shields and other masks, etc., etc. And when I told them that we take the things only in donation through CSR, most of them ran away. Because it's, you know, many of the organizations have created middlemen and agents for this. And this is a bad scenario. And when we are facing a pandemic, we are also facing a time crunch. And when a precious time of managers is wasted in some such activities, I feel very bad. We should have communicated to the people in a right approach that we don't need this. Lot of people came with a very strange demands that I would like to share with the young students like you. One mantri came to me. You will not believe. He said, I have a mantra which should be kept in your Naidu hospital so that your patient gets recovered within 24 hours. I said, I am ready to put you in the room where there is a positive patient and he will get, you know, real vibrations from your mantra. Instead of keeping your mantra on paper, why don't we, you know, we can allow you to sit, to be seated beside a positive patient. Then he ran away. So these are the kind of people who are approaching us, and you know, we need to take care about this.
Yes, right, sir. So I think what you just mentioned about the mantra, I think that is what is pseudoscience, basically. Science that sounds nice, but is actually not scientific or backed by fact. And that has sadly, thanks to WhatsApp University, being spread very, very much. Even, you know, every day we see in news some kind of cure being propagated.
So that is very difficult to distinguish between real and false. So,
yes, exactly. And I think in a country where while there is literacy, true education is still a major problem. This is a big problem. They don't know how to converse, but to the is a big issue. And that happened. The next question is about the CM's core team. You were a member of that, along with the commissioner of Mumbai and a couple of other stalwarts in the field. So basically, I'm asking about the realm of policy making. Now, I'm assuming that as a commissioner, your major role would be in execution. While in this capacity, policy making would be the major role. So what were your experiences regarding this?
No, it is in the social sector or extension programs. We used to call it as lab to land and land to lab kind of scenario, where, you know, you experience something in Pune, and now if I get a COVID patient in Solapur, the faraway places need to learn from already the places where corona has arrived 1 month back. So we got entangled with this policy issue right from day one. We are being guided by the task force of doctors who, you know, guide us on treatment protocol, etc. And policy making is very useful in the sense that day before yesterday, I could guide Solapur as to whether they should go for entire city lockdown or not. Now, this is a perplexing question for the city manager. When we are opening up, there would be COVID patients in smaller areas, towns, urban agglomerations, and even municipal council level. And they get perplexed. They only learn through some reports and news that this needs to be done. So they need some guidance on this. And on weekly meetings, we share the thoughts with each other and then try to have a common understanding on policy issues. This helps in tackling COVID more exactly in the faraway places.
Right. So we are almost at the fag end of our conversation. We just have one last question from Mugdha Thakur. So the question is again with domestic violence. Are there any specific helplines that TMC has come out with, or what is the issue in regarding to domestic violence?
Are he either other than the social justice department's helpline, we created one special helpline for the psychological treatment, number one. Number two, for domestic violence, our ward officers, you know, they can be approached at any point of time. Then community, wherever the such incidents are happening, they can put their, you know, complaint on our website as well as district website, because the block development officers and tehsildars in rural, and you know, urban local bodies and revenue officers in urban, they are tackling with the domestic violence cases, and you know, they can be given the help of counselors in the first phase, and then we move the courts for proper adjudication of the domestic violence cases.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Finally, as we come to the end of the question answer session, I would like now, you, if there are any parting comments that you would like to give to the audience at large. And also, if there is any message to citizens in general.
I would request every young one to have a scientific temper that the Constitution has promised. Because, you know, we need to be rational. We need to make choices. It is high time. You know, every student learning in any college, any technology college or anywhere in India, has a rational attitude. And, you know, this rationality alone will make us, our citizens, independent. They will be more logical. They will be in a better position to make choices. They will be better equipped in taking decisions. And probably this is the dream that Constitution has thought about all the future generations of the country. And let us work together on social causes. Let us have education while learning, and learning while taking education. And some of the students, as I said earlier, some of the students can engage very actively with the social organizations from day one. And we can have some skill development kind of program where, you know, while taking education, nowadays youngsters in India are also thinking that they need to be independent. They need not, you know, their money, pocket money should not come from parents. They should be, you know, working on their own. That's a good sign I see for the future generations. And if they are ready to work, why can't they work with all organizations, right from health, education, local bodies, everyone, and earn their little money and learn. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I'd be presenting the motion of thanks. First and foremost, a very big thank you to Gaikwad, sir, for taking such precious time out. We understand that you have your schedule filled with so many things, meetings and everything, and still you took out time to talk to us. That is indeed we are very grateful for that. I'm sure all of us have learned so much from your experiences and your wise counsel. This is something that definitely we cannot imbibe via newspapers or news channels. A one-on-one conversation like this indeed has such a big impact on all of us, and it's inspiring for all of us. I'm also thankful to administration of VIT Pune, Director Sir Dr. Rajesh Jalnekar, and Dean of Student Affairs Rajesh Dhake Sir, VIT Pune MUN team with the Secretary General Komal Mekela and Deputy Secretary General Aditya Yavalkar, and all the team. And finally, a big thank you to all of the audience which has connected with us today. Thank you for taking your time out. It has been a lovely session, and I'm sure all of us are going to take home a lot of lessons and wisdom from sir today. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ayesh.
Thank you so much, sir. Okay.